Hi, this is Jeffrey Reddick, creator of Final Destination.
Greetings, Slashaholics. This is David Bergantino, author of the Freddy Krueger's Tales of Terror books, the Bard's Blood Horror Shakespeare books.
Hey guys, this is Jason Brooks, Jason Voorhees from Friday the 13th Vengeance.
Hey, this is Slasher Pepper.
Hey everybody, it's CJ Graham, Jason, Friday the 13th, part 6.
This is William Pattison, known to Friday the 13th fans as Eric Morris.
Hi, this is Deborah Voorhees from Friday the 13th, part 5.
Hey folks, this is Adam Marcus, director of Jason Goes to Hell and Secret Santa.
Hello kiddies, this is John Kassir, the voice of the Crypt Keeper.
Hi, this is Kane Hodder, better known as Jason from Friday the 13th, Victor Crowley from Hatchet.
And you're listening.
You're listening.
And you're listening.
And you're listening.
I just want to make sure you guys know you're listening.
You are listening.
And you are listening.
And you are lucky enough to be listening.
Okay, boils and ghouls, you are listening.
You are listening
to the 80s Slasher Librarian.
To the 80s Slasher Librarian.
To the 80s Slasher Librarian.
The 80s Slasher Librarian.
To the 80s Slasher Librarian.
To 80s Slasher Librarian.
To 80s Slasher Librarian.
To the 80s Slasher Librarian.
To the 80s Slasher Librarian.
To the 80s Slasher Librarian. Keep listening, or I'll kill you.
Tonight's upload is brought to you by our patrons from the Patreon page. That's Cecilia Spears, Hawaii, Carl Leakins, Catherine McClear, Sean Campbell, Iron Alexa, Allison Seib, Ryan Woodward, TikTok 12, Bree, Bonanza Jellybean, and Kai Antez. Thank you guys so much for supporting the channel through Patreon. And if anybody listening right now enjoys the content of the 80 Slasher Librarian YouTube channel, and would like to help keep it going and growing for a long time to come, then click the link in the description below and sign up on Patreon for as low as $2 to $5 per month. You get some great rewards depending on the tier you select, such as the $2 tier gets you the early access content, the $5 tier gets you the early access plus a free ebook emailed to you every 3 months, and every 12 months you get a free gift from the merch store. There's also a $15 tier that gets you a free gift from the merch store every 6 months, a free ebook every 3 months, and you can appear on the podcast and voice a character in an audiobook narration once per month. So there's many choices to choose from. Just click the Patreon link in the description below and check it out. Child's Play 2, The Novelization, Chapter 15. Phil worked his hands under her faded Northwestern U-shirt, expertly covering both her breasts. He tweaked her nipples a little too roughly. But then Joanne thought that maybe she just wasn't in the mood. His knee was grinding away in her crotch. He nibbled her ear. But then he stopped and leaned back. He gave her a long, hard look. "What's the matter?" he said. "Nothing," she said, turning away. But she knew he wouldn't buy that. She wasn't a prissy lover. He liked to joke that it wasn't at all hard to get her motor going. And that was true, and now... "Come on. Yeah, there's something wrong. What is it?" she sighed. "That woman called, the one from the adoption agency?" He waited to let her get the story out. "She said that..." Now she looked away. "We were turned down again." He touched her cheek. She wished he hadn't done that. She couldn't stand him being sweet and gentle. Not now, not today. "Honey," he said, "I'm sorry." "The woman said that there just aren't that many kids to be had. We're still on a wait list. If they get a good match up, someone that they..." Phil sat up and shook his head. "Damn, how long have we been on that wait list? For over a year? And what else do you have to prove to them? You've quit your job, you take these kids in from the center, you stay here and take care of other children, and you get your heart broken every time. What the hell else do they want to see?" "They know all that. It's in our folder, but we just have to wait, like everyone else." Phil stood up. He walked to the desk and fingered the broken statue. "Yeah, well, I hate waiting." He turned back to Joanne. "And I hate seeing you go through this over and over." He paused, and she knew what he was going to say next. "It has to stop, Joanne. It's just too painful for you." But she sat up and shook her head. "No, Phil, I'm still happy. I love these kids, and I do, honest. We're making a difference in their lives, a real difference. Look at Andy. He needs our love, our home, and he's trying so hard to fit in and please us. I think he really likes it here. He really likes us." Phil shook his head. Then he said, "I'm happy if you're happy." She smiled. "I am. You'll see, everything's going to turn out fine. Just fine." She raised her arms to her husband, and Phil smiled and walked back to their bed. There was something wrong. Andy tried to breathe through his mouth, but he felt something, tasted something inside his mouth. He tried to move, but something was holding him. Just another nightmare, he thought. But then he opened his eyes, and he saw the sock, one of his socks stuffed in his mouth, bulging out of his face like a giant wart, and his hands and feet were tied to the bed. He felt something moving on his chest. He tried to squeal, to cry out, but only the smallest muffled sound escaped the sock. The thing on his chest moved, crawling up close to his face, closer, until he saw the head, outlined in blue. "Surprise!" Chucky said. Andy cried, but the sock muffled it. Then he begged God, "Please, please don't let this be happening." The doll's body felt heavy on his chest. It was real, real. Andy snorted at the air. He tried pulling against the sheets that held him fast to the bed, but he only made his wrist and ankles hurt. Chucky leaned real close to him. Andy smelled him, the plastic, and a wet smell. "Did you miss me, Andy? I sure missed you." "Please, God, let this be a dream," Andy thought. "Just another dumb nightmare." But it all felt too real. The sheets knotted to his wrist, the chunky body sitting on him. This was real. He started to cry. "I thought it was over. I thought it was all... I told you, we're friends till the end, and now it's time to play." He watched the doll face break into a mean smile, and Andy could see those teeth, those shiny white plastic teeth that were so good at biting. He watched the teeth move up and down. "I've got a new game, sport. It's called Hide the Soul. And guess what? You're it." The grin grew wider, and Andy screamed, but almost no sound escaped the sock in his mouth. He watched Chucky reach out a hand toward his head. "He's going to kill me," Andy thought. "He'll strangle me. He's strong, and he'll wrap his hands around my neck, and maybe he'll bite me." But all Chucky did was touch Andy's forehead. Andy could strain his eyes upward, and see the plastic hand pressing against his head, and the t-shirt, the stripes so dull in this dark room. He looked back to Chucky's face. The doll blinked and then seemed to look up. Ah, day, dewey, dembela, Chucky said. Andy knew what Chucky was doing. I'm the one he needs, Andy knew. He needs my body, and I'll be... Give me the power, I beg of you. Andale posse dembela. Andy writhed in the bed, squirming like an eel he had once caught in the Hudson River when he was visiting his Uncle Jack. It was a big black eel, and it twisted and turned, shimmering black, until it finally spit out the hook and then went crazy in the bottom of the boat. Uncle Jack laughed and threw it back into the river. But Chucky will never let me go, Andy thought. He needs me. But then Andy heard another sound at the window, a rattling, the window moving. Chucky froze. And then Andy saw hands and a face, and it was Kyle. She was sneaking into the house. He watched her press her hands against the window, forcing it up. Chucky leaned close to him again. This isn't over, you little shit. Not by a long shot. I'm not gonna spend the rest of my life as a stupid doll. Chucky gave Andy's face a hard squeeze. The next time you're alone, you're mine. The window flew open and Chucky became still, his face freezing into a peaceful smile. Andy watched Kyle step quietly into the room. She probably thought I'd be asleep, Andy knew. She climbed right up the trellis into my room. Then he thought, Chucky's gonna get her. He'll wait until she's in the room and leap up and... Andy started twisting and turning again. Chucky rolled to the side, flat now, on Andy's chest. Kyle stepped into the room and then heard Andy's grunting sounds. She quickly looked down at the bed.
Oh my God! What the...
She whispered. She pulled the sock out of Andy's mouth. He gasped and then shouted,
It's Chucky!
He tried to warn her with his eyes.
Look out! He's gonna get you!
Kyle untied his hands.
Will you shut up? You'll wake Phil and Joanne. What happened to you? Is this a trick you learned how to do? Or is this the Manson family partying downstairs?
She doesn't see, Andy thought. She doesn't know that Chucky can just reach up and grab her. He can kill her in seconds. His hands were only inches away from her throat. She untied the other hand, and Andy shrieked.
Kill him! You have to kill him!
Andy! Quiet! You'll wake up Phil and Joanne, and I'll catch hell! Now stop it before...
Kill him! You have to kill him!
Andy repeated, shrieking. His hands were free, and he pushed the doll down to the other end of the bed. The door flew open, and Phil rushed in. He turned the light on. What the... Kyle shot up straight, and Andy saw a sheepish grin on her face. She's only worried about being caught, Andy knew. That's all she cares about. She doesn't believe me about Chucky.
You didn't have to wait up,
Kyle said. Joanne pushed past Phil, hurrying into the room. Andy, what happened to you?
It's Chucky. I told you he'd find me,
Andy cried.
He tried to take my soul. He's going to try again.
Joanne sat on the bed and held Andy close. Shh, she said. Don't worry, Andy. It was just another dream.
But it wasn't a dream,
he wailed. They have to believe me, he thought. Somehow I have to make them believe me. He saw Phil shaking his head. You've really outdone yourself this time, Kyle. Sneaking out when you're grounded is bad enough. But, he pointed to the twisted bedsheets, tying up a little kid so he doesn't blow the whistle? That's a new low.
Oh, come on, Phil. Do you really think that I...
Andy struggled away from Joanne.
Chucky did it. It was...
He looked at the doll sitting lifelessly against the wall now. Just a doll. Just a silly old doll. Joanne put her arm around his shoulders and pulled him close. Shh, Andy. That's enough for now. Phil shook his head. Oh, brother, that does it. Andy saw Phil look at Joanne. His face was angry and mean. He'd like to get rid of me, Andy thought. He wants me out of the house. Phil picked up the good guy doll, and Andy yelped like a puppy when he saw Phil handling Chucky. It is Chucky, he thought. I know it's Chucky. Somehow he lived, and he's found me. Please, Mom, come and get me. Get me away from Chucky, please.
You got to kill him,
Andy said. Phil nodded. Right, sure. Phil turned and started walking away with the doll. Andy squirmed away from Joanne. Andy! She called. But Andy ran to the doorway and followed Phil.
You got to kill him!
He begged him to believe him. Andy got to the stairs and he saw Phil moving down, holding Chucky.
Please listen to me. I'm not lying. Please!
Andy hesitated, and then he started down the stairs, the dark stairs, following Phil. He felt the carpet under his feet scratching at his toes, the soles of his feet. At the bottom of the stairs, he saw Phil turn and head for the kitchen. Where's he going? Andy wondered. What is he going to do? Andy called out please to him again. He didn't want to follow Phil into the kitchen. It was so dark in there, and he was so alone with Chucky. He begged Phil to listen. He swore he wasn't lying. And stopped in the foyer. He heard a door open. He chewed at his lip, and then, after taking a big breath, he ran into the kitchen. Phil was at the cellar door, and there was a light on. He shouldn't go down there, Andy knew. He shouldn't go down there with Chucky.
If you don't kill him, he'll come and get me.
Phil stopped and turned to face Andy. He still held the doll, dangling it from its feet. The light from behind Phil made it impossible to see his face. Was he mad or was he smiling? Or was he listening? Andy, Phil said quietly, calm down. I'm gonna get rid of the doll. You will not ever see this doll again, okay? Andy took another few tentative steps inside the kitchen. The floor was so cold, and he saw a milky white light outside in the backyard.
You have to kill him,
Andy whispered.
You have to kill him, in his heart, or he'll...
Phil nodded. I'll get rid of him, Andy. Don't worry. It's going to be all right. Andy nodded. He backed away. It was too cold here, too dark, and he didn't like the strange light outside. Phil turned away and brought the doll back, almost as if he were going to swing it at Andy. But then he threw it down into the cellar. Andy stood there listening to Chucky hit one step and then tumble down the rest of the way. Phil reached up and pulled the string, and they were both in the dark. I'll get you too, Chucky thought while he was still cartwheeling through the air. Yes, he thought again with the first thump on the wooden steps. I'll take care of you, Mr. Suburbanite. We'll fix your wagon and your stupid little wife, too. Lots of things we can do here. He banged down the steps, head over heels, each thwop sending another reminder that his soul was being locked into this made-in-Taiwan body. Then finally his head cracked against the concrete floor of the cellar, and he nearly screamed from the pain. He was in the dark. The light was off and the door was slammed shut. He heard Phil call, but... He's gone now, Andy, okay? He can't bother you anymore. Chucky heard something else as well. Something down here, chittering and moving. Right down here. And now, this was a first, sports fans. There were smells. He was smelling again. Dank, wet smells. Nearly as bad as that rat hole he had shared with Eddie Caputo. Poor Eddie. If Eddie hadn't left him behind, none of this would have happened. And Eddie had to pay a big ticket price for that error in judgment. Poor bastard got spooked and fired his gun when he didn't know the gas was on. It was instant tenement removal, rats and all. That's what Eddie was. Just another big rat. Chucky reached behind and felt the crack in his head. Ow! That was nasty. A real split in the skull. But he noticed as he sat up that it didn't appear to affect his thought processes one bit. Then he felt something wet drip onto the top of his overalls. Oh shit! No! He thought. Not again! He reached his hand around and felt his bloody wet nose. He looked at his fingers, catching the pitiful amount of light in this dungeon. He heard tiny, tiny feet sniffing close to him. More blood. It's getting late. Too late. It has to be tomorrow, or I'll be trapped, he thought. The feet scuttled closer. He thought he felt wiry hairs brush against his back. He figured the rats must be sniffing the blood, and that they were probably getting hungry being down there. The rat came closer, and its hair stuck through the material of his shirt. He smelled the fetid breath of the animal. It must eat some pretty weird shit down here. Chucky waited just a few seconds before he turned around and grabbed the rat around its neck. It twisted in his hands, which were strong and powerful. No, I got you, Chucky said. The rat tried working its needle-nosed snout around to chew at Chucky's hand. But Chucky bowed his arms out, so just the hands held the rat and it couldn't bite anything. The rat coughed and Chucky increased the pressure. He heard more sounds, more chittering and movement. The other rats were moving in for the kill. Chucky pressed harder until he thought he heard something snap. A wet goo leaked out of the rat's nostrils, over Chucky's hands, and onto the stone floor. Man, that's gross, he hissed, and he threw the rat off into the corner. He heard the other animals swarm after it. He guessed that they wouldn't be bothering him for the rest of his short stay down here. Okay, Slashaholics, this has been Chapter 15 of Child's Play 2, the novelization of the motion picture. Hope you guys are enjoying this book so far. And again, thank you, Cecilia and Bonanza Jellybean, for voicing Kyle and Andy. I really love having you guys in the book. It really helps bring it to life even more, in my opinion. I thought this was a great chapter. It's pretty much copy and paste from the movie, but that is one of the best scenes in the movie, you know, when Chucky reveals to Andy that he is back and he's going to get that soul, you know. And the whole, got a new game for you. It's called Hide the Soul, and you're it. Which we get a lot more of Hide the Soul comments in Child's Play 3, which I will actually be narrating on the channel as well in the coming months. If you guys are enjoying this one, please let me know in the comment section. I really need your feedback on this book. If you're actually enjoying this Chucky book here on the channel, I really need to know. And, you know, if you're excited about Child's Play 3, the novelization coming up later, probably in a month or two. I'm enjoying narrating it, you know, and as I've said since the beginning, I know I'm not a perfect Brad Dourif impersonator. I'm just doing the best I can with Chucky, trying to make it at least sound familiar to what Chucky sounds like. I thought about using audio clips from the movies for, like, when he's doing the voodoo chants and stuff, but it just wouldn't match up with what I'm doing, and it would just be weird. But I am actually having a lot of fun voicing Chucky. It's a lot harder than voicing Freddy, I tell you that, but it's a lot of fun, too. I just hope that I'm not driving anybody away from the book with a bad impression or something. A few of you have given me some positive feedback on it. Thank you so much for the feedback. I'm just really insecure about it at this point because it's the first book I've ever done, trying to do the whole Chucky thing. But I'm really enjoying it because this book means a lot to me because the movie itself is one of my favorite horror slasher sequels ever made. And, I mean, it's just the perfect example of how to do a sequel right. And I thought it was cool getting back into Chucky's head again in this chapter, after Phil has thrown him into the basement. Of course, in the movie, he's just thrown down, you know. It's hard for a movie to really, you know, give you insight to certain characters, especially like Chucky. But that's what I love about these books. We're able to get into his head, and here he is thinking about Eddie Caputo from Part 1, the guy that drove off and left him. And he's right. If Eddie hadn't done that, none of this would have happened. That's what led to that fateful night. And, of course, another iconic part, Chucky's nose bleeding, letting him know that it's almost too late. He's got to, you know, he's got to get the ball rolling. He's got to get it rolling soon. As far as the length of the movie compared to the book, the author's got to be adding a lot more stuff to it because we're only like halfway through the book at this point. I think there's 30 chapters and we're on chapter 16 after tonight. And, you know, we're pretty far into the story of the movie. So I'm thinking that as we go along, there's going to be some more extra goodies and stuff, and I'm really looking forward to that. As with a lot of the books on this channel, this is my first time reading the book, too. I like to narrate books the first time I read them. It just makes it more fun for me, and I put a lot more into it that way because I haven't read it before, you know, and it's more exciting. Hope you guys appreciate that, too, you know. Tell you what, this past week or so, doing two or three uploads a day, it's been a bit rough on my voice. I might have to take a day or two off this coming weekend, but I promise I will get right back after it, putting out as much content as I can. We're living in a crazy time right now, and we're all, you know, sheltering at home or social distancing, isolation, quarantine, whatever you want to call it. And I know that there's not a whole lot of stuff to do to pass the time, and you can go stir crazy. And I hope that I'm doing at least a small part of entertaining you guys and keeping some fresh content out for you guys to listen to. And hey, if you're not caught up on the content on the channel and you need something to do, like I said, there's like over 40 completed books on the channel right now, older uploads. Just check my playlist section. There's plenty to listen to. I hope it helps pass the time in these crazy times. Hope you enjoy it. I hope you're all being safe out there and everybody's safe and healthy. Take care of yourselves. Love you guys. Don't want to lose any Slashaholics to this. So please hang in there and just be safe. And I'll be back very soon with more of Child's Play 2. Until then, this has been your friendly neighborhood 80s Slasher Librarian saying, thanks for listening, and I'll see you next time.
There's a lover in the story, but the story's still the same. There's a lullaby for suffering and a paradox to blame. But it's written in the scriptures and it's not some idle claim. You want it darker? We kill the flame. They're lining up the prisoners and the guards are taking aim. I struggled with some demons, they were middle class and tame. I didn't know I had permission to murder and to maim. You want it darker? The flame.